Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues a series entitled, Operating in the Spirit Realm. The gospel message almost disappeared after 325 AD when Christian churches became state institutions and its members were no longer born again. Salvation was restored under Martin Luther in the 16th century, water baptism came next with the Anabaptists in the 17th century, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit was restored in the 18th century under the Moravians. It was the baptism of the Holy Spirit that ignited the Methodist revival fires in England and America. The fire continued to spread when Charles Finney, D.L. Moody, Hudson Taylor, and C.T. Studd were also baptized in the Holy Spirit and started to preach on the subject as well. The Holy Spirit still operates in the same fashion today, and the question remains, have you received the baptism of the Holy Spirit? This message is entitled, The Story of Pentecost. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, worldwide, on March 23rd, 2014. And today we have a long sermon, so to say. It's a hope to be a moving sermon for you, as we're going to trace the story of Pentecost. And I believe it is very, very important that we know the history of Pentecost, and also know the history of Christianity, how it was lost and then found again. And if you have a Bible, I'd like you to turn with me to the book of Acts. That's the book of Acts. We're going to look in chapter 2. So the book of Acts, the second chapter, and verse number 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Why is it that some people do not want to have the Holy Spirit, or do not want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? And the reason is that there's been a resistance. And we're going to share today how Satan took over the church, and then how God came back again and rebirthed salvation, water baptism, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, the power of the gospel simply lasted about to 325 A.D., and after 325 A.D., the Christian churches were formed into a state religion where we had the Roman Catholic Church, and there was a Coptic Church, but basically the Roman Catholic Church ruled over Western Europe, also over Africa, and part of the Middle East. What happened now was this, that the teachings of Jesus, salvation, being born again, water baptism, baptism of the Spirit, healing, and so on, it simply vanished. And for about 1,200 years, the gospel were more or less hidden. There were small groups in Europe, in the Middle East, in Africa, there were remnants, but they were isolated, did not have any power. They had power with God, but they did not have power to reach out. And so what happened is this, that for about 1,200 years, 99%, I would say 99.9% of the world's population were born, lived, died, and went to hell. Now, I want to speak to you, here, and those of you watching and listening right now. You might say, that's awful. And the truth is, it was very awful. If you could go down to hell and talk to those millions and millions of people that lived during these different centuries, they would simply say, it is not awful, it is catastrophic. Because we are going to spend eternity in the lake of fire, and the only reason for that is there was no one preaching the gospel. That's what I want to tell you this, that you are important. Every man, woman, boy, and girl are very, very important to understand that your life will determine people standing behind you if they will be saved or not saved. God did not find a man 300, 400, 500, 600, 7, 8, 9, we come up to about 14, the 15th century. And in the 15th century, he found a man that he could use, Martin Luther. He's been vilified lately, and people are saying he was a bad person. But I want to say this to you. Martin Luther is going to take his place in eternity with honor, because he's a man that brought back, you have to be born again. You have to be saved and born again. That was Martin Luther. I want to finish reading here what it says in John, actually in Acts 2:39. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourself from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day were added unto them about 3,000 souls. The denominations that came up after Martin Luther. Now, Martin Luther, if you read his biography and study his life, he was baptized in the Holy Spirit. But you see, he was not able to bring the Reformation full circle. He labored all his life to break the monopoly of the Roman Catholic Church, just to survive, to translate a Bible into German, and to lay the foundation for salvation by faith. And that's all about that he could have done, and he did. If you turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 3, the Gospel of John, the third chapter, and you pick it up in verse number 3. Jesus answered and said to him, verily, verily, I say to you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say to you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Martin Luther loved the Lord as a young man. He became a Catholic priest. He was also a monk. He was not saved, but he had a desire to know God. So he did everything the Catholic Church taught. There's a special castle in Europe that has about 130 some odd steps going up to the castle. And when they made the stairs up there, when they poured the concrete, they put in broken glasses, pieces of broken glass, every step. And he simply say, if you really want to come close to God, then you got to go up on your hands and knees on these stairs. And that will make you come close to God. Martin Luther did that. He got bloody knees, bloody hands, but he didn't get close to God. He did all kind of other penance. He fasted. He tried this. Hail Marys. Burned candles. He tried everything. And then in his frustration, he cried out to God. And then God led him to the letter to the Romans. And the Holy Spirit showed him that it is by grace you are saved. I really want you to catch this right now. You see, you can hear a truth and you don't understand it. But when Martin Luther read this in the Bible all by himself, Holy Spirit was there, suddenly the Holy Spirit opened up his understanding. And he said, saved by grace, no works. And at that time he repented. He asked God for forgiveness of his sins. He simply trusted in Christ and asked Jesus to be his Lord and Savior. At that moment, he was born again. After more than 1,200 years. Now, after he was born again, he was filled with the Holy Spirit. He couldn't be quiet. And he began to preach the gospel, how to be saved. There was a revolution that took place. The Roman Catholic Church was shook. And Satan tried to do everything he could to stop it. If we move on now to Matthew chapter 28, we look upon the next thing that was restored. And here is something very remarkable that I cannot understand. And that is simply this. When somebody gets a revelation, they have been persecuted. And then God gives a second revelation. The Lutherans begin to persecute the Baptists. After Martin Luther had started the Reformation, there was beginning an awakening. We had the gospel preached in Germany, in France. We had the Huguenots in France. And by the way, most people do not know this, but France had a fantastic revival in the 1600s, when you had almost half the country born again. They were called Huguenots. That part of the church did not survive. And the reason for that is that when you had the French Revolution, they simply massacred most of the Huguenots. Some of them came to Canada, some came up to the United States. But that branch of the church was killed off. But now men begin to, as they were born again, they begin to read. Matthew chapter 28, verse number 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given to me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. We do not know specific leaders, but it started up in Switzerland with the Anabaptists. And these were men and women, they got enlightened, be born again, and they read Romans chapter 6. That's the book of Romans. And we have the sixth chapter. And you pick it up here from verse number 1 through 4. What shall we say then? Should we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know you not So many of us, as were baptized into Jesus Christ, was baptized into his death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into his death. And like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. If you sprinkle a person, there's no burial. And as he went back and looked upon history, he found out that John the Baptist was in the River Jordan, and he was simply immersing people. They put them down under the water and brought them back up. That was a baptism of John, which was then picked up by the apostles. We had them baptized into Jesus Christ, into his church. So now a new movement began. They split the Lutherans or the Protestants. Some of them simply says, well, we're going to keep the infant baptism and the sprinkling, which the Lutheran church had to this very day. But there were breakaway groups, big groups, and they begin to call them Anabaptists. The Catholics and the Protestants joined together there. This is amazing how Satan works. And they begin to persecute the Baptists. One of the favorite tricks they did in Europe was they would go in and take a church, maybe be 50 to 100 people there that were Baptists, and they would simply chain them up, take them on huge boats, put weights on them, and then they would come out to the middle of the lake and says, okay, you're Baptist, we're going to baptize you for good. They tossed the first person over. That person would drag the second one over. And then the whole gang, so to say, just rolled into the water. And that's how they drowned them. And they thought, this is how we're going to stop this. God was not pleased. They couldn't stop it. Because God wanted water baptism through immersion to be restored. And it was established. Too many Baptists emerged, and they couldn't stop them. And finally, now we had two things restored, salvation and water baptism. But you see, the gospel is not complete yet. And now God moved upon a man by the name of Nicholas Sinzendorf. He was a count in Germany, a rich man. And he simply decided, he was a noble man, and he bought a huge estate. He had been born again, water baptized, and he wanted to do something for God. I want you that are listening to me right now to understand that. God used Martin Luther, one man, changed the whole world. The Baptists came along, different places, changed again. Now Count Sinzendorf came along, and God was now going to use him to restore the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He purchased an estate, and then he invited all persecuted groups. Every persecuted Christian in Europe was invited to his estate. We do not know who the teachers were, what happened, but we do know this. They were born again, they were baptized in water, and suddenly large numbers of them were baptized in the Holy Spirit. We're not talking about 1600, mid-1600, late 1600. What was the result of this? Some of you never heard about the Moravians. It would do you good to look it up on the web, study it, find out what these men and women did. But you see, when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, you cannot contain the gospel. You got to share that. And suddenly, missionaries were sent out for the Moravians. They send out missionaries to all different parts of the world. and they begin to preach salvation, water baptism, and a baptism of the Holy Spirit. And again, we have the restored, as is spoken about here in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 4 to 6, where Jesus said, "Tarry until you Jerusalem to receive the Holy Spirit." As we follow the road of Pentecost now, we now come to a young man by the name of John Wesley. Now, John Wesley was a young man. He loved the Lord. He was from England, had gone to college. He started a group to study the Bible, but he was never born again. But he had a Methodist. He had a method. That's why his followers were called Methodists. And I want to show you now what people can do in the flesh. He simply felt, you know, I'm called to preach. But he wasn't saved yet. So he decided to be a missionary to Georgia, in what is later now in the United States. He came to Georgia, got a church, Episcopal church, and then he got in trouble. One of the men's wives liked him. There was a lot of rumors, and he had to flee north, where they would have tarred and feathered him. Came up to New York to find a ship back to Europe, and beaten. Failure. Guess what? God had on that ship some Moravians. One of the men took interest in John. He shared with him about being born again. All the trip back was one thing that John Wesley noticed. When everybody else was scared to death by the storms coming and the ship was going up and down, the Moravians were sitting down, singing, praising God. They showed no fear. John Wesley got back to London, couldn't get peace in his heart, went over to a Moravian meeting, and as he was there, he understood, I have to be born again. They prayed with him, and John Wesley was born again. He decided this, I need more. He spent about 2 to 3 months in Germany at the Moravian Center. And there he was baptized in the Holy Spirit. If you talk to Methodists today, if John Wesley would come down and look upon a Methodist today, he would say, these are not Methodists. These are reprobates. This church is apostate. That's not the church I built. Because they were called shouting Methodists, filled with the Holy Spirit, praising God, taking the gospel out. Circuit preachers in the United States, a tremendous move of the Holy Spirit. But now, the Baptists said, we don't like this. And now there was a persecution that continues to this very day of the different Baptist denominations. They reject the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and they are dead set against it. The fire spread. And I listed some of them here. Charles Finney, fantastic evangelist. If you read his story, he was baptized in the Holy Spirit, filled with such power that he couldn't contain himself. Started a revival in the early 1800s. Then you had D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody, Congregational Church, dry as a bone. He had been born again, tried to preach, but he didn't have the fire. And then after a few years, two ladies dogged him. They sat on the front row. Every meeting he had in the United States, there were these two ladies. And they were praying. He could see that. And finally he said, "Lady, what are you praying about?" "We pray that you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit." He got mad. He didn't like that. They kept praying. And one day, I'm just really moving fast in history. Dale Moody was in New York. He'd been bugged by this. And he simply said, there's something to this. I need it. I pray for it. On the street in New York, fire from heaven came down, hit him so hard, he couldn't contain himself. He didn't know what to do. He just rushed to a friend's house, burst in and said, give me a room, shut the door, let no one in. And there, for hours, he basked in the Holy Ghost power. When he came out, it was a different evangelist. Millions and millions of people got saved under his ministry. His master of the Moody Bible Institute, R.A. Torrey, we're talking about now late 1800s. He got baptized in the Holy Spirit. There was a fire going, but the Baptists were fighting it. And R.A. Torrey wrote a little book, The Baptist Holy Spirit. But you know, you go to the Moody Bible Institute today, and they deny the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They had dried up. Satan come in and seared them. They're preaching salvation, water baptism, but not the power of the Holy Spirit. Hudson Taylor, C.T. Studd, and a number of others simply spread the fire. But here's the thing what happened. People were baptized in the Holy Spirit in the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s. But it was sporadic. It was not a move. It didn't sweep. It simply, the fire did not take off until 1900, Topeka, Kansas. This is where we have Charles Parham, a holiness preacher. The baptism of the Spirit preached by D.L. Moody and the others created a holiness movement. And they were longing for the baptism of the Spirit, but they had not received it yet. And Parham and his wife opened a work in Topeka, Kansas. And again, I want you to notice this. One man and his wife. One man and his wife. And they took in some students. And they said, we're going to be preaching and teaching on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Suddenly, one day, this is not controlled by man. One of them there, Agnes Usman, was sitting in the classroom. And suddenly the Holy Ghost came down. Boom! Hit her hard. And she began to speak in tongues. And she began to glow. And just tremendous power hitting her. Parham and the others looked and said, wow, it happened. And they said, now why her? Why not me? And they began to pray and seek it. And suddenly, the whole group was baptized in the Holy Spirit. Now, Parham simply decided now that he wanted to spread the fire. And he started to go out and preaching missions and so on. But the press came on, negative press. And not enough people baptized the Spirit. And it looked like the movement had died out. And then became the city called Galena. This is a mining town in Texas. Roughneck town. And there suddenly, as Parham had been preaching, people were baptized, not one, but entire congregations. And suddenly now we were talking about 10 to 15,000 people that had been filled with the Holy Spirit, were speaking and praying in tongues, laid hands on the sick, prayed for the sick, had all kinds of miracles. And now the fire spread from there to Texas. God had a special way of doing it. In those dear years, black people were looked down upon. There was a name, it was a guy by the name of William Seymour, a black evangelist, holiness evangelist. But because of the segregation of laws, he could not be in the meetings where white people were. And he had simply to sit outside. They opened a window, and he sat outside and listened. But you know what? God is not a God of respect of people. God walked outside and baptized Seymour in the Holy Ghost. And man, did he get the fire on him. He was sent from Texas down to Los Angeles. And the church had called him there. Now, I want you to notice one man. You see, I'm speaking to some people today. God has been calling you into the ministry. God's been calling you to do things for the Lord. And you said, well, I'm just one man. I'm just one woman. What can I do? I'm old. I'm young. I'm this. I'm that. It doesn't matter what you are. It matters who's in you. If the Holy Ghost is in you, it doesn't matter who you are. Things can happen. Now, Seymour got out to Los Angeles, preached in that church the first time. They called him. And he was hired in the morning and fired in the afternoon. They said, we don't want to hear about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We don't want to hear that. We're holding this church. And there he was now. He didn't have money, could not go back to Texas. He lived with a family. Do you think he was discouraged? You better believe he was discouraged. And he labored for about 2 to 3 months. Bible studies. Nothing happened. Teaching. People got saved, but no Holy Ghost. And he was just praying and teaching. But you see, God is the author. God is the one doing it. And one day, after about 2 to 3 months, Seymour was together with a man that was in his house he lived. And this man had a vision. He had seen the apostles. And they showed him how to be baptized in the Spirit. And he said to Seymour, he said, now pray with me, pray for me. And he said, just the two of them are there together, praying. Here comes the fire. Boom! And hits this man. He begins to speak in tongues. He begins to manifest the power of God. And Seymour just standing there and saying, wowee. And then he leaves him, goes to his evening Bible study. He's excited. He says, you know what? The Holy Ghost fell on so-and-so in the house just an hour ago. And suddenly, the power came in that Bible study. And all of them were baptized in the Holy Spirit. They couldn't contain themselves. Now, they went run-down buildings, black and whites together. And then suddenly, it could not be contained. The message spread. And they rented Azusa Street, a building on Azusa Street. And now everything was going full bore. The revival of the Holy Ghost had hit. Why do we need the baptism of the Spirit? Because it is a power. Jesus said to his apostles, don't you dare to leave Jerusalem until you have been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Then you go out. So what happened at the Azusa Street? People began to come in from all over the world. There was one man. He was an English man. His parents had moved to Norway. His name was Charles Barrett. And as the newspaper spread this out, now we talk about 1906, it spread to Norway. This is the day there was no telephones, newspapers, telegraph. And Barrett decided, I'm going to go to Los Angeles. He went. He was baptized in the Holy Spirit. He came back a different man. Began to preach in Oslo, Norway, capital of Norway. And his church exploded. And suddenly now, the fire was not like it had been before. Entire congregations, it was moving. There's a little Baptist preacher in Sweden by the name of Levi Petrus. He's a good Baptist. He heard about Norway, Oslo. He and his wife went up there. And guess what? They got baptized in the Holy Spirit. Came back. His church was no longer a Baptist church, but not a Pentecostal church. And after that, the Baptist Union in Sweden split. And I have been talking to some of these men in my lifetime. And they are dead set against the Holy Spirit. Had one man, one of the preacher, was his church. He was sick. Had a revival there. People got saved, healed, delivered, baptized in the Holy Spirit. He came back the last day sick of a dog, but he went up and stood and spoke. He says, I don't have the miracles this guy has. But he said, I'm faithful. I've been there for 35 years, or whatever you've been there. And then he simply called up the headquarters in Stockholm and said, as long as I live, this John Torell shall be driven out of Sweden. We don't want him. 2 to 3 years later, this pastor was dead. God took him out. It's a tremendous resistance against the Holy Spirit. The Swedish Baptist, the Swedish Pentecostals, they took the message to Finland, to Baltic countries, to Russia, down to Germany. Clergy from England went to Los Angeles, took it back to England. And I do not have this in my outline, but it was one man, Gunnar Wingren, and another Swedish guy, two young men, Swedish guys, lived in Chicago. This goes back now to about 1915 or something like that. They were baptized in the Holy Spirit. And one day, as they were praying, they had a vision. And they saw a map. And they saw a city, Para, P-A-R-A. And they said, now what in the world is that? In those days, they didn't have the internet. They had to go to the library. They went in and searched and found out that Para was a small coastal town in Brazil. These two Swedes could barely speak English. And God spoke to them and said, you are to go to Para, Brazil. They told the congregation. Congregation says, well, whatever. They blessed them. They gave them enough money to go to New York. This was days before they had airplanes. Now they were in New York, in a port. There was a boat going down toward Brazil. How much money did they have? Nothing. I want to build faith in your young people. You see, you are so used to have everything served on a platter. As they stood there and looked at a ship and prayed, a man came up from behind with an envelope, stuck in their hands, and vanished. They opened it up. There was enough money for a one-way ticket for both of them. You see, when God sends you out, he sends you on a one-way ticket. It is not like, you know, round trip. You go out and try a little bit, then come back if you don't like it. They came down to Brazil, got in land in Para. It was a little Baptist church there, some other missionaries. And they received them well. until they opened their mouth and began to preach. Now, they preached in English that was broken to begin with, didn't speak Portuguese. But guess what? As they began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on some people. The Baptist says, we're not going to support this. Presbyterians said, we're not going to support this. And they kicked them out. They were beaten. And they said, we're stuck now in Brazil. No money, no place to go. Didn't know the language. But they prayed somehow, had enough support. And in time, we're now talking about the entire Pentecostal movement in Brazil was birthed by two uneducated Swedish men that called in Chicago. And today, Brazil has the fastest moving Pentecostal church in the world. Are you listening? God is calling you and me to the work in these last days. Turn me to Matthew right now. The book of Matthew, chapter number 13. Matthew chapter 13. I want to pick it up in verse number 24. You know, when the devil can't beat you, he will join you. And Satan decided this old trick. He did it back in 325 when he joined the churches and started the Roman Catholic Church. And he simply said, I'm going to join the Pentecostal movement. In Matthew chapter 13, verse number 24, we pick this up. Another parable put Jesus forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. When a blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, there appeared the tares also. So the servant of the householder came and said to him, sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? From whence then has it tares? He said unto them, an enemy has done this. The servant said to him, would you then that we go and gather them up? But he said, nay, lest while you gather up the tares, you root also up the wheat with them. Let them both grow together unto the harvest. And in a time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather you together first the tares, and bind them in bundles and burn them. But gather the wheat unto my barn. The sad thing is that Satan sowed discord. Out of a tremendous move out of the Azusa Street in Los Angeles, as the fire spread out to the whole world, infighting started. You see, Satan simply had, there's some people that have, they have a need to be the boss. They got to be in control. If you get four or five people like that in one congregation, it's not going to work. They're going to split that congregation. And they split it. And here's what I want you to see right now. Instead of a mighty river going down over the entire earth in unity, where people are saved, baptized in water, baptized in the Holy Spirit, and in the unity, the river split into more than 700 brooks. There are more than 700 Pentecostal denominations today, plus a lot of independent works when people simply say, well, I'm going to do my own thing, instead of cooperating and working. And I'm sure you've seen the Toronto Blessing, the Pensacola Revival, Brownsville, Todd Bentley. I don't know if you remember him or not. His favorite trick was when somebody came up, He had one woman come up, she had a problem. He simply took his had boots on when he preached. Kicked her in the stomach. She fell on the ground. He says, okay, now she's going to get healed. She didn't get hurt, but it was not the power of God. He would knock people down. And while he was preaching, he was having a woman in adultery on the side. His wife was living up in Canada with the children. God TV simply pushed this wildly, and this wildfire spread until the plug was pulled on him. But you know what? He married his mistress and simply said, well, we are soulmates. And today, he's back on TV again, preaching. Listen, God said this, let the tares stay. Don't root them up. We just let them grow together. Make sure that you are not a tare, but that you are a wheat. What went wrong with the Pentecostal movement here? There aren't many good Pentecostal churches. There's a lot of good things going on. But you see, here's what happened. You had men from the south or the north. These guys had no education. And they simply took the word of God and they superimposed American culture on it and simply said, you know, we got this doctrine now. And it simply destroyed the movement. Most churches today celebrate Good Friday. Jesus was not crucified on a Friday. It was a Wednesday. But you know, no pastor dares to change that now. That lie is too deeply entrenched. Let's talk about a wedding. Now, Jesus spoke about weddings, brides and grooms and so on. And the tradition in America is this, that when we have a wedding, the father of the bride pays for the wedding. In Israel, it is the father of the groom. Now, if you take an American wedding and superimpose that on the teaching of the Bible, you end up in the boondocks. It doesn't understand, make sense. It was the father of the groom that furnished the robes. He paid for it. And if you understand that right, you understand what Jesus taught. You go out today and ask a normal, let's say any person in the congregation today, what's the difference between the moral law, the practical law, and the sacrificial law? This is, I didn't even know we had laws like that. They don't know. They simply told us, we're not legalistic here. We're saved by grace. Anything goes. That's why the churches are rotting from inside many times. Then, teaching people this, you are saved by grace, but you got to work hard to keep that. If you didn't work hard to keep that, you're going to get lost. You're not going to be saved. The question on this, how much hard work do I have to do to stay saved? No one knows. Everyone got their own rules. Don't do this, don't smoke, don't drink, don't chew, don't cuss, and so on, you know, and women do this and let them dress that way, and, you know, come to church when the door's open, you're fine. Who says? Man. How many of you have heard preachers say this? Isn't it amazing? You had a crowd on Palm Sunday, cheer Jesus, and then a few days later, they asked to be crucified. Two different crowds, not the same crowd. These are the things that simply crept in and destroyed the foundation of this Pentecostal movement. What about the truth? Let's turn quickly to Ephesians right now. That's Ephesians. And you should not simply say, well, Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, I belong to that, and so on. And I'm okay. You came because you belong to Jesus Christ, not any church. And you're based upon the Bible, not necessarily a man-made doctrine. And I'm going to give you this now. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 8 through 10, we read this. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself, it is a gift of God, not our works, lest any man should boast. That's the gospel truth. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus in the good works, which God has before ordained, that we should walk in them. I do good works because I'm saved. I do live a holy life because I'm saved. I don't live a holy life to be saved. The second thing is in Matthew 28. That's Matthew chapter 28. And we picked that up, that's water baptism. Matthew 28 chapter. If you read this. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go you therefore and teach all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. That's what it says in my Bible, King James. Now, a bunch of Pentecostals called the United Pentecostal Church, UPC International. They simply says, no. We don't baptize that way. We baptize in the name of Jesus only. What do you do in Matthew 28? All those are just titles. We don't really believe in the Trinity. Have you believed this? You don't have to be saved, you got to speak in tongues. You don't speak in tongues, you're not saved. Besides that, you got to follow all the rules we have here in order to get to heaven. Simple. Baptized in water by immersion in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Can't go wrong on that. In Acts chapter 2, I'm not going to read that. We've read that many times here. What we'll do today. You should be baptized in the Holy Spirit. If a church is not teaching a baptism of the Holy Spirit, it is a turkey farm. Going back to the old days of the Baptists and the Lutherans, the Presbyterians, and so on, they're simply saying no. I want you to really hear me right now. Let's say we have Jesus standing right here next to me. And I would ask Jesus this. Jesus, tell me and this congregation, what are your pillars in the church? Jesus would look right at you and would simply say this. You need to be born again. And all goes, amen. You need to be baptized in water through immersion in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Most of us go, amen. Then he would say this. You need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Half the crowd says, How can we take away a truth in the Bible that Jesus spoke himself and say, we don't practice that? You know what you're doing? You're simply saying this to Jesus. You're going up to Jesus and simply saying, move over, Jesus. We got our set doctrine. And don't you dare to come in and mess it up. Three things. The next thing is, you want to be in a church where they know how to cast out demons. Turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. That's the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. You know, I wonder what Jesus would say if I could take him to the seminaries today where professors are teaching. And this is not only Baptist seminaries. This is even Pentecostal seminaries now and Presbyterian and so on. It simply says, well, you know, Jesus was a child of his day. He didn't know any better. Everybody believed in demons in those days, so Jesus believed in it too. And he just were part of the culture. tell it to Jesus. What do you think Jesus is going to tell you? He's going to say, you know what? You're full of this or that. That's garbage. Are you saying that I, the Son of God, when I walked on this earth, did not have my mind and the Father together? Are you saying that I was some kind of a moron? That's what those professors are saying. I feel sad for them at the judgment when they're going to meet Jesus. And he's going to simply say to these men, you destroyed my word. You took out portions of the Bible. And you know what your reward is? The lake of fire. Read the last chapter in the book of Revelation. Now, in Luke 9, I want to go verses 1 and 2. If you read this, then he called his 12 disciples together, gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. That's Jesus. He says, now you got them, cure them. Cast out the devils. Heal the sick. If you're going to belong to the church, that should be preached to that church. Then we should pray for the sick. Also, we have it in chapter 10 of Luke 10. The same command again. Have you picked this up here? After these things, the Lord appointed all the 70 also and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place where he himself would come. Therefore said unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray you therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he should send forth laborers into his harvest. Verse 9, heal the sick that are therein, and send to them the kingdom of God has come nigh unto you. Verse 17, and the 70 returned together with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are served unto us through your name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents, on scorpions, over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall be by any means hurt you. Now, Jesus simply said this, this power I give with you, notwithstanding, rejoice not that the Spirit has sent to you, but rather rejoice, because your names are written in heaven. It's a sad day in this ministry. We do cast out demons in this ministry. Number one, I preach the gospel. We do baptize people in water in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost through immersion. We do cast out demons. We do believe in the baptism of the Spirit. And right now, we have a backlog. We have a backlog of people in different parts of the United States and other nations waiting to be able to fly in to Sacramento, to be delivered from the demonic forces. Why? It shouldn't be that way. There should be a church in every city where they would do that job. And you know what is really bad? It's simply this. That we had, about maybe 2 years ago, had a team of about 10 people that we were doing all deliverances. And guess what the devil did? He took most of them out. And we down to skeleton crew. And I simply would like to help people. I got this one lady from East Texas. She's been ritually abused, Satanism. She's only 4 years old when her dad took her to a satanic group. They put her in the altar and abused her. And she's crying out and saying, you know, I need help. I said, lady, I want to help you, but I can only take so many. You got to stay in line. You got to wait. It's a sad day. Why is it? Because there's not enough people. As simple says, we are willing to learn, to be set free, to be trained, so that we can do something in the name of Jesus. That's what it's going to take. And then, The gospel should be preached all the time. Matthew 28, we're going to read it again. And then we have something very, very important in Matthew chapter 6. That's Matthew chapter 6. You see, there's no shortcuts in God's kingdom. Matthew chapter 6, you have to forgive. Matthew 6, 14, we read this. And for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. I found this out when I was an evangelist going to different churches. There are half the congregation, or more or less, have unforgiveness. They will not forgive. And I remember one time we were in a church in Santa Rosa, California, had a youth revival. And the youth had a revival. Sunday morning I preached. And I preached on forgiveness. I told them, God has moved among your children, but he will not move in this church unless you are willing to forgive and forget and receive forgiveness. The power of God fell. Southern Baptist Church, that altar was packed. I think just about everybody came up. A lot of weeping, a lot of praying, a lot of hugging, a lot of bad things coming out in the open, a lot of healings. But you see, you can't have shortcuts. You've got to live a holy life, my last point. 1 Peter chapter 1. That's 1 Peter chapter 1. And you pick it up in verse number 14. You cannot sit in front of a television Saturday night or play video games of violence and filth and sex and then come Sunday morning and expect the Holy Ghost to move upon you. You know why people say my church is dead? Because there are too many dead people in the church. Unless you live a holy life, nothing will happen. 1 Peter 1, verse number 14. As obedient children, not fashioning yourself according to the former lust in your ignorance, but as he which is called is holy, so be you holy in all manner of conversation. Because it is written, be you holy, for I am holy. And if you call on a father who without respect a person judged according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. It simply means this. The only thing you have is time. You realize that? Before I came to Christ, Sunday was a bore for me. This was before the internet. I couldn't wait. I just wanted to kill time. Today, I don't have any time to kill. How many hours, days have you wasted on board games, sports, this or that? Today is video games, movies. Didn't do any good. Filthy stuff to begin with. But that's what we've done. And now we're coming down to the end times on the earth. And you're saying, okay, God, what can I do? It needs to be a radical change in you. Let me just try to pull this together quickly. Before I came to Christ, I worked to make money so I could make more money and more money, buy more stuff, do this, do that. That was my goal. After we came to Christ, my goal was to make enough money to put bread and butter on the table, pay for the rent, pay for necessity, and spend the rest of my time preaching, ministering, praying. For 4 years, my wife and I, we were lay people. And during those years, I was a Sunday school superintendent, taught Sunday school class. My wife taught Sunday school. We did visitation. We taught Bible studies. We did a lot of different things, and we practically lived for church. We rejoiced going to prayer meeting. You know, today when I say you want to come to prayer meeting, I don't know. I don't like so-and-so. I don't like to pray like that, you know. We had prayer meeting. We rushed to the prayer meeting. Visitation times, God knock on doors and tell me about Jesus. We were ready. If you don't have the fire, ask yourself this. When to have a fire? If you were on your way to heaven, to have the greatest future in the world, and you simply say, praise God, I'm saved, I'm this and that, you know, and you look around and see all these people that are lost, and you say, well, who cares about them, you know? I'm going to heaven, who cares? That's not the spirit of Christ. Jesus looked on Jerusalem. He wept and he said, I have compassion on you. Oh, have I ever wished to gather you up and save you. Jesus wept for the lost. He died for the lost. But somehow, the fire in many of us had got cold. There's nothing worse than a cold stove on a cold day. Are you ready to stoke the fire? You can have it rekindled. It can be rekindled right now. And what you need to do is to reread again my outline and go through the scriptures, because I just kind of breeze through it very quickly. But just ask yourself this. If you had 1 week left on this earth, if you would have an angel that would come to you today when you leave here, or when you turn me off after we are done, and then you would say, next Sunday at 9 p.m., you're going to take a flight to heaven. You're done. How would you live this next week? Would you waste and just live like you normally do? Or would you simply say, man, I only got 7 days left? It is sad that you would have to change. You see, if you're really living for the Lord and you're doing what you should do, you would say, fine, I will just keep on doing what I'm doing. But most people simply are wasting their time. If you have not been baptized in water by immersion, you should. If you haven't been baptized in the Holy Spirit, you should. If you get demonic problems, you should have them removed. And you can start this way by simply doing this. You that are here today, don't stand up, please, because you block the cameras. But those that are watching me right now, I want you to stand up in front of you. If you're on TV or if you're in front of a computer, whatever you are, and just pray with me right now. My Heavenly Father, I come to you right now in the name of Jesus. And I'm sick and tired of being on a back burner. I want to have the fire of the Holy Spirit fall on me right now. Holy Spirit, fall upon me right now and saturate me from the top of my head to the sole of my feet and loose me. Loose me right now. And he will. And you are not saved. Charles is going to come in a few moments and speak to you and tell you how to get saved. If you're backslidden, why not today say, dear God, I want to repent of my backsliding. I'm sorry, Lord. Take me back and use me again, Father God, and burn out the sin and the dross in my life. I preach my heart out there this morning. It's up to you not to respond. You can be another Martin Luther. You can be another Parham. You can be another Gunnar Wingren. You can be who knows what you will be. Man or woman of God. And it can start right now when you make a solid decision for the Lord Jesus Christ. May God bless you as you take that thing, step. Call us, write us, and let us hear from you.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth, and your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank You for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with You. Help me to be obedient and to walk with You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You have been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the seventh part in the series, Operating in the Spirit Realm, and was entitled The Story of Pentecost. If you are going to operate in the spirit realm, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is an essential component of the Christian life. The gospel message disappeared almost completely after 325 AD, but saw a restoration beginning with salvation in the 16th century, water baptism in the 17th century, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit in the 18th century. It was the baptism of the Holy Spirit that ignited the Methodist revival fires in England and America. The fire continued to spread with Charles Finney, D.L. Moody, Hudson Taylor, and C.T. Studd in the 19th century. This led to a holiness movement in the United States in the latter part of the 19th century and the birth of the Pentecostal movement in the 20th century. The story of Pentecost continues to live on today. God is looking for men and women who are willing to preach the message of the cross, but He also wants you to be baptized in the Holy Spirit and operate in supernatural power. That is the true story of Pentecost. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1436. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can learn more about Pastor Terrell's ministry, read insightful articles, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.